Hey, what's going on, everybody out there? This is Jakejames Lugo. Welcome to the channel and welcome to a brand new episode of A Definitive Discussion. I hope you guys have been enjoying all the episodes I've been uploading lately. I've had a bunch of really cool guests, but I also have a really special, awesome one with me now. My man, Mike Martin. How's it going, Mike?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great, man. So welcome to the show. I mean, you've done a bunch of stuff and it's going to be cool because we get to talk about fighting games, we get to talk about the FGC, we get to talk about competitive gaming and stuff. You've done a variety of content related to Yahoo Esports. You've done stuff on your own personal blog. What else have you done that's related to fighting games?
Oh, am I allowed to cuss on this?
Of course! Like, come on, this is me.
I freelanced. I was freelance writing for a while and kind of made my name, I guess, as a fighting game expert. And so, yeah, I turned that into sort of a career, Yahoo Esports, where I do all the writing and video stuff. We cover events and whatnot, all mostly Street Fighter and I guess Smash. But, you know, I try to dip my toes. I've been trying to spread the love around more.
Nice.
To the rest of the FGC. But, video was kind of a new thing for me in the last year. But, of course, besides playing games and whatnot, just trying to cover the scene as best as I can as it goes through this strange, wonderful, awkward time that we call esports.
It's like puberty for a competitive gaming, almost, in a sense, like, because it's like a lot of stuff still being figured out. There's a lot of discussions being had between a variety of different avenues and such, which is pretty cool. You know, it's good for the scene. It's good for the environment for a lot of people and stuff.
Yeah.
Now, you've done a lot of different content. You've done stuff, you know, including tackling specific subjects about competitive gaming, specifically fighting games. You've talked to a lot of pro players out there, like a couple of the big ones I think you've talked to. I think you've talked to Ricky Ortiz. I believe you did a whole interview with her at one point. And then what are some of the other players, again, because I'm trying to think off the top of my head, of the ones that you've done? You've done a lot of big ones, I know.
I've done stuff with, of course, Daigo the Beast, Umehara.
The Beast.
We did a really nice, I don't know what you'd call it, I guess sort of like a mini documentary, feature kind of video thing with him. Went to Singapore and of course hung out with Sien,
nice,
who Evo 2013 champion. And yeah, I mean, I've talked to a lot of people, I guess big and small, it's funny. What keeps popping in my head is we've done a series called Food Run, which, it's changed in a little bit in how I originally envisioned it, but I mean, they're still great videos. And we just put out the most recent one with PR Balrog.
Yeah.
And everyone, for some reason, I feel like we got more feedback on that one.
Really?
We had done like four or five, I think, before that. And yeah, I feel like I got more feedback on that one and just everyone expressing how much they loved it. And it's funny because someone, I don't want to name names, but someone I kind of beefed with for a little bit called it dinner dates with top players. And I still think that's kind of funny when I think about it.
That's
but
a funny name.
To be honest with you, I'm like, damn, why didn't we call it that? I don't know if we're going to do more of those. And so it was really actually kind of cool to see the feedback, a lot of positive feedback. I mean, people were like, oh, this is the best one. I love this series. And I'm like, nice. Well, where were you guys with the other five?
Now, why do you think that one specifically got a lot of attention or got more positive feedback or feedback in general than the other ones that you did? Because granted, it's PR Balrog, obviously. He's got a lot of fans. A lot of people follow his stuff. He's a great player, plays, you know, phenomenally. So, but what do you think about that episode that really kind of sparked everybody's attention?
Man, I wish you know how it is. Anyone that does anything media related or, you know, like writing, video, anything, you know, you just never know, right? Like
exactly.
Something just, it's like catching lightning in a bottle.
Definitely.
I mean, from the perspective of like, how big his following is, he's easily as big as, you know, someone like Sien or Filipino Champ,
great
Ryan
players.
Hart. Yeah, Ryan Hart we did. Excuse me. And I'm trying to think of the other one now. I feel bad because I can't remember. whoever it is probably going to kill me. But at any rate, I think that maybe it was just sort of timing. He's a very, you know, PR Balrog's a very popular guy to begin with. But I think it's part of maybe that and the timing and you know, he's not that any of the other guys aren't friendly or whatever, but maybe it just kind of has something to do with him just being really, I don't know, relatable.
Being
I think.
Him? Just being genuine?
Yeah. I mean, none of the, it's not like these other guys weren't. Like, don't get me wrong. But I wish I could pinpoint, like, any one thing why that one seemed to have such, like, made such an impact with people.
Yeah, that gravitas, basically.
But it did. And, you know, part of it, too, is, like, I think also he's really not afraid to speak his mind on a lot of topics. Like, one of the things that I forgot that was included in that video was the top... he named off four, technically, but, like, the top three most boring players to watch.
Oh, man. That must have caught shade.
And he said Cian was number one, F-Champ was one of them, and Justin Wong was one of them. So it was pretty funny, but he's a really genuine guy, and I love Eduardo to death. So I love all those guys to death. The one from Singapore with Cian is still one of the best things I feel like I've ever done in my life. So I'm glad I got the opportunity to do stuff like that.
That's an awesome thing to be a part of. Again, just taking the trip out there and just, again, building that from the ground up. That's really cool. But we're going to get into all those different types of facets about fighting games, the FGC, competitive gaming, mm-hmm. and stuff, because it's a very complicated thing to tackle. It's a very complicated thing to understand because there's so much nuance to it. There's so many facets to fighting games, to competitive gaming, to the FGC itself. A lot of people call competitive gaming, it's, you know, at least from people that I've interacted with, call it the FGC, even though they're really speaking about competitive gaming as a whole. It's just that the FGC obviously is probably one of the most vocal communities when it comes to competitive gaming. They're the ones that are usually out there, again, doing all these tournaments, the ones that are getting a lot of television time. Granted, there's other games out there like MOBAs, you know, RTSs that get similar stuff. If not, they have their own crazy big scenes and such. But let's just focus on fighting games now, because obviously that's your forte. That's what you know. That's what you understand intimately and such. Mm-hmm. So for someone like me, again, I'm a fan of fighting games. I've been a big fan of Street Fighter for many, many years. Again, Street Fighter was one of the games that you played on Sega Genesis and Super Nintendo. I mean, I didn't grow up in the arcade scene, but a lot of us understood that's where it was homegrown at, and that's where it had its origins with. Again, just the idea of playing another game against another human being in a competitive setting, go fighting for prizes, pots, and different stuff like that. But coming at it from the outside, looking in and such, There's many different things that get a lot of attention in the FGC, that get a lot of attention in just the fighting game scene in general and such. What would you say is probably the one thing that everybody kind of, you know, gravitates towards or always brings up whenever, like, a discussion about the FGC or just fighting games comes up in conversation?
From, like, a casual perspective or
casual or pro? Because I would assume pro would be, like, obviously tournaments would be, like, again, being part of that scene, winning, making it to the next big one, possibly, you know, stuff like that. But either or is fun.
I guess where I'd say right now is the biggest topic or issue is probably just Street Fighter V in general. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a... From the esports perspective, there's a Capcom Pro Tour, which I think does a lot of great things for competitive fighting games and you know, the FGC. But a lot of people are participate, and that's great. Like, it's wonderful that we're at a time that it exists and that other games and other sort of companies and publishers want to emulate what they do.
True.
Unfortunately, I think whether it's casual or hardcore, I think the biggest issue right now is Street Fighter V. It's not for everyone, and it actually doesn't make a lot of. It's at least it's vocal. It may be a vocal minority, but it sure is a loud vocal minority. It doesn't make its players real happy at the moment, and I think that's kind of unfortunate.
Now, I want to explore that a little bit more, because we've actually had discussions about this in the past, like on Twitter and such. Like, I think me and you have two different opposing views on it, where at first, and I want to talk about it around launch time, because obviously Street Fighter V has changed as a game since it first came out. You know, not only is there other modes and stuff that was added to it, like the story mode, and a lot of the changes to the characters and stuff have changed up the competitive environment in one way or another. But I remember at launch, a lot of people were very divided about that game, myself included, where... As a longtime fan of Street Fighter, I'm huge into the series. Again, I played most, if not all, the games, and I read the manga, I watch the anime and stuff. So I consider myself a hardcore fan of Street Fighter and such. But, you know, that might not be the same for other people. And I remember one thing that you were talking to me about is that, you know, Street Fighter V is not for you. It's for the hardcore people that love that competitive scene. That it was a game built gameplay-wise for that crowd, because it's that crowd that goes to the tournaments and stuff. And I didn't feel the same at the time. I mean, again, things have changed since then, but I know a lot of people felt similar on both sides of the equation.
Well, I don't, it's not necessarily that it was built only for hardcore gamers, hardcore Street Fighter players or competitive players, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
It was built with that in mind, with esports in mind.
Competitive gaming, basically, for anybody listening that doesn't know.
Right. But the issue is, it was intended, I mean, it, you know, for all intents and purposes, it was a game intended for everyone. Before the game released, I mean, I spoke with Yoshinori Ono, the producer.
Ono-san.
Ono-san, what? I guess that was PSX 2015?
Last year's PSX. Not 2016. The year before. The year before, yeah.
Yeah, the year before. And, I mean, we talked about how this was a game that wipes the slate clean and that they wanted to appeal to, you know, just like with Street Fighter 4 when that launched, they wanted to appeal to people, you know, new and old. New as in, like, hey, there's a new Street Fighter out, I should check this out. Or old as in, hey, there's a new Street Fighter out and I haven't played it in years, I should check this out. And I think at launch...
It's a very complicated thing because I mean, there was all sorts of stories about it back then.
Yeah, I mean, at launch, obviously there was a lot of issues. For one, the online didn't work. Yes, I mean, what they sold people for $60 retail, in my mind, was not a value. But I still don't subscribe to the it was an incomplete game. I think it was complete for what they sort of wanted it to or needed it to be for competitive gaming. In hindsight, at this point, because if we talked about this, we as in the community and everyone in the industry have talked about this a lot.
Yeah.
And in hindsight, I've seen some examples of why an arcade mode, not a story mode, but an arcade mode would be important to people. And that's something I feel like I've kind of gone back on. Because I felt like, well, you know, look, nobody plays Street Fighter for arcade mode. Like, I don't play Street Fighter for arcade mode. But in hindsight, I feel that, you know, there are a lot of people that do. There are a lot of people that, hey, they don't have a lot of time. So they just jump on it. And then if they don't want to play online, they just jump on the game, you know, fire up arcade mode real quick and finish, you know, playing that. Maybe unlock some things, whatever. And that is something that I think was integral to Street Fighter that a lot of people, or that Capcom misjudged, that a lot of people would want in the game.
I mean, a lot of people spoke out about it, I remember, at one point. I mean, there was this weird thing that I remember even back at the time, and looking back at it now, maybe I was a little bit naive to the fact where a lot of people kept saying stuff about how Capcom wanted to get the game out before the Pro Tour, I think it was, because sometime before Evo.
And I think that's absolutely true.
You think it was absolutely true? Like, that was at least one of the deciding factors at the time?
The game launched 2 weeks before the Capcom Pro Tour started. So it had to be out before the Capcom Pro Tour started. If it wasn't, then, you know, what do they do with their Capcom Pro Tour if their game doesn't launch on time?
True.
I don't really believe that it was a game that, hey, we're going to... I don't think they went into it necessarily feeling like we're going to scale back the quantity of content in the game. I just feel like they had a completely different approach, and esports was the business model, or esports defined their business model for Street Fighter V. Now, in hindsight, whether that worked or not, you know, it's
very subjective.
Yeah, but I definitely feel that they missed the mark on a lot of things. There's no doubt about that. And I have been one of those guys that I love the game. I love playing the game. I'm satisfied with what I have. But at the same time, I understand why people want more. And I understand that, you know, the game's not perfect and that they aren't still doing a great job at some things.
Hmm.
But having said that, it is, they're in a weird situation right now. I've kind of mentioned this, and I haven't really written about it because I'm actually supposed to talk with them soon. So I've kind of been holding off, but they're in a really weird situation right now. they're kind of caught in a void. They're caught in a vortex, to use a Street Fighter 4 term. They're caught in their own vortex.
They're caught in a frame trap.
Because they are now trying to take a game that appeals to the hardcore competitive side, and everyone's complaining about the gameplay and, you know, season two and why'd you do this to this character, all these different things. You know, the input delay, which is still 6.5 frames.
It used to be like eight, right? I think it was 8 or 7 frames.
It was eight, right. And the average game is usually 4 or 5. So this is really heady stuff, not for the casual player. But having said that, the other issue is, while they're trying to appeal to the hardcore competitive side, they have a game that they're still trying to sort of appeal to a casual side as well. And I feel like they're kind of caught in this. They've been put themselves in a vortex where they're not entirely sure how they satisfy either one. And I feel like they kind of need to pick one and just go with it. If you're only going to be a competitive game, you've already sold your 1.5 million. I think they finally reached 1.5 million. And I don't see that, you know, unless you relaunch this game as a Super Street Fighter 5 and offer more, that it's going to significantly sell more copies. So I feel like you should pick one and go with it.
Now, to play to one more point before we move on that I'm actually kind of curious about, because I want to get your opinion on this. Now, I feel like a lot of this would have been different had the game maybe been a little bit cheaper, maybe even on like the $40 mark. I think that maybe some of the reactions from everybody would have been a little bit different. But I also feel like now, in the wake of all that, now that things have happened and we're almost about a year or so later and we're moving into more further into season two, that a lot of the stuff that happened now is heavily going to influence Street Fighter 6. Whatever that game turns out to be, like, things I feel like might get done almost kind of like the opposite of like how they handled Street Fighter V, or at least different enough in a fashion that's going to be noticeable to a lot of people. I mean, would you think that's a fair assessment? And I don't just mean just like the amount of content included. I mean, just like, again, you know, taking everything into account, everybody's reaction to it, not just the casual scene, but also definitely the competitive scene, the guys that are going to these competitions and stuff.
How controversial do you think it would be for someone to say that they don't believe there will be a Street Fighter 6?
I don't think that's controversial at all. I think that maybe they won't call it Street Fighter 6. I would be more inclined to believe that, personally. Because I don't think that Street Fighter is a series that will ever end. Because I feel like it's way too popular. People know Street Fighter as a brand and stuff. But I do believe, like, you'll get another Street Fighter game. But whether they call it Street Fighter 6 or not, you know, that's up in the air.
I mean, obviously, this game is 10 days away from being a year old, and they want this game to last easily as long as Street Fighter 4 or longer. It's really hard to say what they are doing or what they will do with this game, how that affects the future of the franchise. I guess I agree that Street Fighter will kind of always be around, because it's always going to be sort of the most popular fighting game.
It is, straight up, but, like, right next to Mortal Kombat's right next to it. You could argue Tekken, but I feel like Street Fighter's that brand name that when you think of when it's fighting games.
But I don't know. I mean, this was their stab at trying to make something. It feels like they tried to make something sort of competitive and esportsy, like League of Legends, but didn't want to go all in. And part of that is, you know, you're dealing with Capcom Japan. You're dealing with two sides of Capcom, Capcom Japan and Capcom US. And when it's not one entity. So when one entity doesn't have sort of control over everything, we've seen it over the course of this game.
Sega, primary example.
There's issues. I don't know how it affects the future, because I don't know that they know. I really don't know that they know how this game, I think I know what they want at times, but I don't know that they know how to show that to the players and the fans. And they're certainly not doing it in a way that appeases, like I said, both sides, both hardcore and casual.
Like, they're almost indecisive?
I don't know that it's indecision as much as I don't know that they really know how to express. I mean, communication is still an issue. sure. with Capcom right now. Is still, I think, gameplay elements aside, I think their biggest issue right now is still communication. And I think that is the, people complain about like input delay, why you took away my reversal, DPs, all that. The thing they need to fix right now more than anything is communication. And it maybe speaks to a larger problem in that they still don't know how to communicate amongst themselves. I don't know that how it affects the future of the franchise, like a new game. My guess is if there was a Street Fighter 6, I have a feeling they would approach it very differently. I don't know that they would go sort of three quarters in, because I don't know if I feel like they went all in on esports, but I don't know that they would go three quarters in on esports. I think they would reassess, and I think they're doing it with Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite.
I think that's a fair assessment.
Capcom Infinite will be how that game launches and how that game is handled is actually going to tell us how any future fighting game from Capcom will be handled.
Interesting points overall. So let's move on to talking about the scene. Let's talk about the community stuff, because that's what you know. You intimately know the FGC. You intimately know players that are part of it, big name players. Mm-hmm. Again, like you mentioned before, Daigo, PR Balrog. Again, the list goes on and on and such. It's safe to assume that really the FGC kind of gets a misunderstood rap sometimes, and for a number of different reasons. Again, it's very complicated. For every good or amazing thing, there's always a bad thing, and that just goes with every community that's out there and such. If you could name me one good thing about the FGC and one incredibly bad thing about the FGC, you know, because again, good goes with bad almost all the time. Pick those two things that you feel like really speak volumes to what is great about the FGC or what can be improved by the FGC.
Let me start by saying that I don't necessarily feel like the FGC is represented. I mean, I suppose we're talking in media, whatever, as on a one-to-one good versus bad. I do feel that when let's be real, FGC hates Kotaku because Kotaku writes about negative stories that usually involve the FGC. As someone who's worked in traditional games media, I understand that, hey, when someone does something at an event and the Capcom Pro Tour bans them, I mean, that is
news.
Something that's going to be written about. It's going to be covered. But as far as like what the good that they do, what is good about the FGC, I think that my favorite thing has always been that it is a community. It's kind of like being a family. Sometimes it's dysfunctional.
Dysfunctional.
Sometimes they're, you know, they're,
it's like the Osbournes.
I mean, there's bad things that happen, but those are, I feel like that's rare compared to like, you know, good stuff that happens. But it's community. I just did a video last week talking about the Evo vote, which is of course a player's choice vote for the final game and the main game lineup for Evo 2017. Mm-hmm. And you know, one of the topics that I talked about was that, yeah, we're still a sort of a fractured community in that the fighting game, people think when you say fighting game community, you just think, oh, it's all fighting games, right? Well,
yeah,
I mean, there's still anime, there's still Street Fighter, there's still like NRS, the NetherRealm games with like Mortal Kombat, Injustice. Those are different sort of communities within Pokken, which of course you're playing all
yes,
the time.
Of course, yeah.
Tekken. I mean, at the end of the day, I think that we're all a community. Would I like to see a little more unity amongst all of those different scenes? Yes, but ultimately, I think that's the biggest positive about the fighting game community. I mean, it's like, you know, if someone finds out you play fighting games, and even like the Smash FGC sort of argument, right? Like, I know that's a thing, but I feel like more people are coming around to that's not really an argument to have anymore. But as an example, I was at the grocery store one day, and a guy happened to see one of my shirts, you know, one of my game-related pop culture shirts, whatever. He's like, oh, what do you play? I was like, oh, right now I've mostly been playing fighting games, whatever. He's like, oh, you're part of the FGC? I'm like, yeah, I play Street Fighter, and I work, you know, for Yahoo, and blah, blah, blah. And he's like, oh, man, that's so cool. He's like, I play Smash. And part of me would have been like, that discussion could have ended right then and there. for a lot of people because they're like, yeah, fuck Smash, that's not a fighting game. But I'm just like, that's great, you know, because like here's an opportunity to kind of, you know, get to know someone and be like, yo, well, where do you play? Like, do you go to, you know, do you go to tournaments? Do you go to like any of the weeklies or like local sessions, things like that? Mm-hmm. And I think that's the beauty of the fighting game community. That's also how it grows. You meet people and you're like, yo, you should check out this local session we do like Tuesday nights up at in Seattle where, you know, there's Smash, there's Street Fighter. Yeah.
Which is really awesome.
Gets people interested in games. And then, you know, if they, again, this is where I think Capcom kind of missed the mark with Street Fighter V. If you got new people interested in your game and you were able, you know, they were able to play with the game, stay interested long enough that they then, you know, start thinking about, wow, I could, maybe I should look into this whole competition thing, or they find out about tournaments or whatever. You know, that's how the community grows. So they go to these local sessions, they go to these tournaments, maybe they get bopped, but if they, you know, if they're really willing to get better, then they'll make more friends and they'll start, you know, talking with people about strategy or training with you know, players. Like, I don't get to train with the local guys nearly as much as I'd like. It's hard doing a full-time job and having two young kids to do anything, right?
Yeah, right.
But that's the beauty of the FGC.
True.
The bad stuff, I don't know. Like,
again, it's very complicated, I feel like, because, I mean, you could say any one of the typical things that people would go to, more than likely, again, whether to bounce off of it before we even really get into that, you know, to kind of bounce off of what you were saying. Like, one of the cool things that I think about when I think about the FGC is that it kind of reminds me of like a classic Shaw Brothers Kung Fu film. Like, if you remember, like, in classic, like, Kung Fu films, like Bruce Lee films and stuff, you got those groupings of, like, dudes and stuff that are, like, you know, they're all about their Kung Fu. They're about their style of Kung Fu. They're about their clan, you know, a little bit of clan mentality and such here and there. But it could be fun sometimes, you know. It's a little bit Smash Mouth, like you mentioned, where, you know, there's beefs and stuff, and there's always that typical, like, okay, who's the better? Because it's a competitive environment, you know. Fighting games, by their nature, are competitive and such. And I think that could be really cool. That's at, you know, from what I've seen personally, because I think I've only gone to one Evo event, which was back in like 07. It was a long time ago. So things have definitely changed since then. But like, that was one of the things that I took out of it. And I remember being a part of that, being someone that's coming from the outside and going into that and just experiencing it for the first time. Like, to me, I always thought that was cool. But I also think, like, to your point, it's like, just, you know, the more you find a lot of people, especially in the scene, that are very open to either being instructive to people that are brand new, but also being welcoming in a sense where, you know, they want to represent their game. So a lot of people understand is like, listen, the only way that my game stays around or my game becomes even more relevant and stuff is if more people see it and more people understand it and more people get enticed by it. And I find lately now, within the last few years that, again, that I've been covering games and stuff, I'm starting to see that a lot more often, which I think is pretty damn cool.
It can be, and I don't know, I guess maybe my bad stuff is going to be the flip side of what I just explained to. I think there are people who, yes, if you want your game to stay relevant, you of course need to build on your community. But there are people who still believe that their community is the best or the only and only one. Yeah, I mean, it's one thing to think that, like, hey, like, look, I love Street Fighter. I am not a Mortal Kombat guy. I will always like Street Fighter over Mortal Kombat. That's just me. But I think that the mentality of, like, my game deserves to be here and yours doesn't is also what holds the community back as a whole and keeps the community, the FGC, fractured amongst smaller communities.
I agree.
And I think there's nothing more evident than that than seeing Evo put a, you know, 9 games up for vote to make the final game at Evo 2017 and telling people, if you want to see your game in Evo, vote with your wallet.
Because, yeah, you know something? Oh, well, I'm sorry. I didn't want to interrupt. I'll say a point afterwards.
It becomes an issue of pitting communities against each other, and it becomes an issue of, well, and again, I wrote about this. I talked with Mike Z, the developer of Skullgirls,
nice,
about this. If you have the Marvel community, which is probably easily 100 times bigger than the Skullgirls community, who would win in that vote? You have much bigger personalities. You have a much larger community, and frankly, you have more money, more disposable income,
and a legacy
to pour into that game getting into Evo versus Skullgirls, which twice now has been a part of the vote and has always been, you know, to be fair, has always been, I think, sort of shafted by Evo on the outside looking in, and that's rather unfortunate.
Now, here's the thing that I wanted to say before, and I didn't mean to interrupt before, but sure. I agree with you on all that stuff. And the thing I never understood, and again, I understand a lot of the phrase that gets tossed around, and they kind of relate it to something like Smash, you know, in relation to Evo and such lately in the news, is that people would really think that it's a logistics thing where you can't have all these games represented at such a big event. Because to me, I always looked at Evo as like the biggest tournament, period. Like, it's the biggest fighting game competition ever. And a lot of people would also throw in, Super Battle Opera and a few others, like, here and there. Again, when you start going international and such. But, like, I always thought, it's like, to myself, it's like, why can't you just have, like, all these big games represented? Because there's so many communities now of fighting games, or at least so many kind of, like, types of fighting games that have their own fan bases and such. And I was never like a real big fan of, like, you know, pushing one to the side in favor of another. Now, again, with that being said, I totally understand you can only do so much. You only have so much time. You only have so much space. You only have so much resources to devote to, like, prizes and stuff like that. But one of the things that really got on my nerves with the recent thing about Evo that you mentioned with the donations to charity and choosing the games and such was that was one of the factors that motivated people to stick behind their games, was putting money behind it, which what got people enticed. Like, for example, in my case, I like Pokken Tournament. Granted, I don't go to a lot of Pokken Tournament, competitions and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I've always represented the game. I've always, like, streamed it. I enjoy being part of that. I love interacting with some of the people in the scene. But, like, even though, despite me supporting it all that time, there wasn't really a lot of support for Pokken Tournament for a long period of time. Up until something like this, where everybody all of a sudden started coming out to represent Pokken Tournament because, you know, they were saying that they wanted them to donate money to get it into Evo. And there was all these other things that I just was not cool with. But my point is that there was always this need, or there was always this thing that I was never down with, where it was trying to put one scene against another, where everybody talks about unity and stuff, and everybody talks about tolerance, and everybody talks about, you know, being welcoming in one fashion or another. But then you have stuff like that that's almost kind of counterproductive to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I said this in a video actually today. I think it should go up tomorrow. So we do this thing where it's called I Got Next, where I pick a topic, and Evo Vote was my topic for last week. And what we do is I just spend a few minutes talking about that, and I actually respond to comments and whatnot. Very cool. Or tweets. And I responded to one for this week's video, a comment about the Evo Vote. And I want to make it clear. I made it clear in that video, but the division, the fracture, whatever you see in the FGC, it's, of course, it's not Evo's fault. It's not the sole, you know, reason, or the sole reason for it isn't because of, like, the Evo vote. It's just one of those things that contributes to that division. But yeah, you know, I mean, it's one of those things, like, look, the reality of the situation is, for people that don't understand, most fighting game tournaments were born out of, you know, we call it grassroots. Yeah. They were born out of a bunch of people that said, hey, let's hold a fighting game tournament. Okay, cool. We're now in a situation where esports is a business, thanks to games like League of Legends, Dota, Counter-Strike, and whatnot. Yeah, and so fighting games were sort of a natural. I mean, fighting game tournaments have been around longer than probably any of the other games in esports. Counter-Strike's probably the oldest of the non-fighting games. StarCraft as well, but seems like that scene's dead. But I mean, my point there is, though, that it's not, you know, this isn't all on Evo. I understand what they were trying to do with the vote, but I think also people need to understand at this point, and I think Evo should also be a little more
transparent. I
don't know if it's transparent, but also, because it's not that I feel like they're not. I think the situation is. I think those guys would still like to believe that they are sort of grassroots community, but at the end of the day, I think most of us understand that, look, Evo is the largest fighting game tournament in the world. It's a wonderful event. I've been to the last two. I wanted to go to Evo for years. It's still great. But it is also, you know, saying that it's the largest fighting game tournament in the world, it's also, you know, sort of the largest fighting game esport tournament in the world. And companies are paying money for their games to be there. Pokken Tournament, you know, Nintendo heavily supported Pokken Tournament last year. And that's why it was one of the games at Evo. You know, they take these companies are sponsoring them, and they, you know, they're going with what is obviously popular, but as well as, hey, you know, if someone's going to pay us to have their game in our tournament, then, you know, we have to have it.
Exactly.
So, I mean, there's a business side here that's not great. Going back to the grassroots thing, though, you know, many of the tournaments are still very grassroots, and you don't need Evo to have a scene or a community. Skullgirls is a great example of that. At the same time, if you don't particularly care for that, what do you want to say, like sort of that corporate esports
aspect of it,
of Evo, I mean, Combo Break is a great tournament from what I've seen, and hopefully I get to go there for the first time this year. And Combo Breaker runs like 20 games. So when you were talking about, like, why don't they have more games, whatever, I mean, you know, yeah, they run side tournaments and stuff like that, but the Evo staff, they run the 9 games, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, Combo Breaker runs like 20 games. And honestly, if you want to go to Combo Breaker and play Super Street Fighter 2 Turbo, you have an opportunity. You'll have to figure out how to get it shipped to your place on your own, but you have an opportunity to actually win that tournament and win a stand-up arcade cabinet.
That's
with Super
awesome.
Street Fighter, I mean, like, that's crazy. Like, that's awesome. I mean, to me, I'm like, shit, if we're talking like a few hundred bucks is like the prize, I'm like, I'd take a stand-up cabinet over a few hundred bucks.
Hell
any day.
Yeah. That's awesome. Like, straight up.
But yeah, so, I mean, it's, you know, there's a business side of these things. And I think sometimes people in the FGC, because they're still holding on to their old school ideas, and that's fine, there's nothing wrong with that, but I think they also kind of see it's that thing when, like, you know, like when you're an indie band or whatever and you sign with a major label, well, now you're no longer indie and you're, you know, you sold out, and it's like, dude,
and everybody gets mad.
But that's everyone's goal, right? Like, you want to be successful and you want to be comfortable, you want to, you know. So yeah, it's still a great tournament. I will absolutely love being there. Hopefully they don't ban me for
Nazis. They can't ban you, son. You're too nice.
But I love it, and I will happily cover the fighting game community while I'm there.
Now, I want to explore that a little bit more, because you mentioned grassroots, and mm-hmm. I also link that to what I said earlier about clan mentality sometimes. Mm-hmm. I want to really know and understand, why is it that, again, from what I've seen, it comes mostly from the FGC, why is it that the term esports is such a dirty phrase for some people? Now, again, obviously mm-hmm. it's not just the FGC that just says that stuff. You say that, hear that from a variety of different people, because they always associate the term with a bunch of different connotations that are may or may not be true. But usually every time, like, you know, when I hear about friends of mine going to tournaments and stuff, or I talk to friends that identify with that stuff and they're going to these things, and the term esports comes up, it's really like a nasty term or to them, or at least a term where they kind of like get that reaction. It's like, eh, you know, they don't, it's almost negative and such. And I never understood that, because in the way that you talk about it now, you talk about it was like, okay, well, esports, you know, in a general phrasing, it's becoming a much more larger business, a means to make money for some of these companies, which means bigger events at some point, which could be a positive for a lot of people. But I never understood the outlook on it. So to try to see if maybe you could explain it to me a little bit better.
I think it's because, going back to that indie band example, right? Like, people love an indie band because, I mean, maybe like they like their music, but also because, like, hey, you know, they're indie, they're not part of a major label, blah, 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 right? Mm-hmm. So when you look at fighting games, I think the pushback against being esports comes from the idea that if we allow ourselves to become esports or too esports or too corporate, we're losing our identity. If Capcom last year, Capcom instituted some rules that, you know, I've been told that they were always rules, but they were never documented. Mm-hmm. Against, you know, things like side betting and of course,
the,
you know,
collusion
thing? No. Like literally side betting if you're in the crowd, side betting, because, you know, technically gambling is illegal, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, if you ever go to an event, I mean, there's always people that are side betting. You know, who you like, I'll take five on Justin Wong, you know, that kind of thing. Obviously, their goal was to get rid of harassment or bad behavior.
Bad stuff in general.
Right. It was sort of a knee-jerk reaction to things that happened that got a player banned. But in doing that, they also, you know, put language into their rules against things like side betting and just basically what we call being a crowd monster.
What's a crowd monster? Just in simple phrase, because I've never heard that before.
Imagine, you know what a stream monster is.
Yeah,
right?
I know what a stream monster is.
Okay, so it's the same thing, but like in the crowd, a fighting game crowd. So
you're being guy in the crowd, basically.
Kinda, yeah. Maybe less trollish, maybe less meme-ish. But yeah, I mean, you're just being the crowd monster. You know, cheering, jeering, whatever, talking crap, whatever. So I think the pushback comes from like, hey, we don't want to lose our identity and we don't want to allow a company to come in and define what we are or who we are. And the thing about it is like, if that's fine, like I totally agree with that. That's the thing that makes fighting games and the FGC unique, right?
Yeah.
Like I think we can still be unique while also being esports. But the fact of the matter is, all of these guys that show up on the Capcom, you know, at events on the Capcom Pro Tour and play Street Fighter V in the hopes of winning or whatever, guess what? That's esports. Like, you are actively participating in esports.
It's electronic sports competition.
So, you know, denying it doesn't make sense to me. I understand the pushback against it, but at the same time, I just feel like it's one of those things like, hey, you know, this is a unique thing and we can still be who we are and still participate and compete in these events. And it's, you know, whether you want to call it esports or not, who cares, you know, whatever. But I mean, it is what it is. And, you know, at the same time, I'm fortunate enough that it has also provided me, at least in the short term, a career. Because we don't know what's, you know, esports is the Wild West. We don't know what's going to happen, but I'm here and I'll do it as long as I can.
Now that's the thing that I always get hung up on that I don't really understand as much, again, from on the outside looking in, is because I don't even see how, like, you know, when you have getting companies involved, putting money up for pots and stuff, how that really changes the identity. I, like, from, again, on the outside looking in, it's always seems to me. No, go ahead.
I think it's because when you have corporate sponsors that come in, and if you have corporate sponsors paying a lot of money for, you know, for this product, to put this product on, to market this product, whatever, then the money is what decides, you know,
what goes.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's the biggest fear of esports, because, you know, grassroots means that, like, hey, you know, we started up a tournament and maybe there was no money, or maybe there was a little bit money. Like, we, you know, the prize is the pot is from the fees that people paid to sign up for the tournament. Or maybe someone actually donated, you know, $500 or $1,000 or whatever to the prize pot. So, you know, that's like, that's the ultimate grassroots level of fighting game tournaments.
But to me, that's like almost the same thing, though. Like, what I was going to say was that to me, it almost seems like people want to say that as an excuse to be able to do what they want. Now, I don't mean that for everybody, period. But like, whenever I see a bunch of people either debating or arguing about it, it always seems like there's one side is like, listen, we always feel like we're going to be limited in what we could do, or limited in how we could actually express ourselves, and limited into like how we've always done things. And I feel like, you know, that's like a two-way street, because you obviously still want to be genuine. You still want to be you. You still want to have your own identity as a community or as an individual and stuff, but also there has to be that compromise for change in order for things to change up, to be better, you know, to get bigger or whatnot.
I think the ultimate takeaway there is there has to be some give and take.
Compromise.
And if you want your game to be esports, which, you know, I think most communities kind of do at this point, just because that's part of how your community grows. And that's fine. Like, you do have to give a little. You know, is Capcom banning the U-Porn team or players from competing in the Capcom Pro Tour if they're wearing their U-Porn jerseys their team YP jerseys at the time. You know, is that what we want? Not really, but unfortunately, that's what happened. Whereas, like, does Capcom really need to be worried about, you know, what the crowd monster does? I don't think so. I mean, as long as they're not doing anything, you know, I guess illegal on stream or whatever, right? Or I don't know.
Unsavory.
I think the issue is, again, it's the fear of losing that identity to the corporation. The corporation, whoever has the most money coming in and saying, okay, this is how things are going to be from now on. You can or can't do this, whatever. You know, what if they come in and say, you know what, we don't really like the way you guys pop off after you win a match. There's no more popping off.
Do you really think it'd get like that, though? I don't think so.
I think the biggest fear is that they, and I guess, spoilers, this is the topic of this week's video that's going up, I think, tomorrow. There's very little in the way, at least right now in Street Fighter V, of sort of like rivalries and personalities and everyone's buddies. Like, you can be buddies outside of game, that's fine. But even in the game, I mean, everyone's sort of like buddies, and it's kind of stale.
I think I understand what you mean. It's kind of like boxing matches or Ultimate Fighting a little bit, where, like, you know, there is that time to be like professional stuff, but you could tell, like, you know, certain individuals just either don't like each other or they're always at odds, and there's character right there.
Yeah, I mean, I think more because I feel like MMA is probably more close to like WWE than anything.
True, yeah.
But I mean, like, boxing, if you go look at like old school boxing, you know, matches and promos and things, like Muhammad Ali is probably obviously the greatest at that. You know, two guys talking shit to each other until they get in the ring or whatever. I mean, that's the kind of thing that I think is missing from, you know, sort of, I'll say 21st century fighting games, right?
Yeah.
This modern fighting games, like the esports generation of fighting games. I think when you look at like Marvel, it still has some of that flair. And especially if you ever see like a Marvel 2 exhibition to this day, even to this day at some of those East Coast events, I mean, that's the fighting game community. Like, that's the core of the fighting game community. And I do feel like that's something that is missing to an extent with games like Street Fighter V.
Interesting. Now, funny enough how you mentioned personalities, there's one thing I do want to touch on as like a good way to kind of bookend this entire discussion. And as one of your views that I've seen in the past, where, and it's not just you, it's a variety of different people, but I really saw it with you, you know, as far as like looking at certain players, you know, especially ones that are, they would consider them celebrities or e-celebrities, you know, people that are out there in the spotlight that are really good players that everybody rallies behind and stuff. There was a couple times I remember where you were open about not speaking or not covering particular players for one reason or another, because whether they were being really vitriolic or really this or that or whatever. And I thought that was a good stance to take, because granted, you know, you want to cut, you as someone who covers, you know, fighting games, you know, as a media personality, wants to be able to cover really good aspects or really thought-provoking aspects about the FGC or about fighting games in general and such. And then you pick and choose based on that and stuff. But can you kind of detail a little bit, or at least your views on, like, you know, why one wouldn't want to cover certain players because of, you know, them being vitriolic, them being very hostile in some form or fashion? Like, why would one consider that?
I think a good example of, and let me just say that of people out there that I wouldn't cover, I guess my there have been people out there that I didn't want to cover that I felt conflicted about, and after talking with them and actually talking with them personally, I've changed my mind. Because I felt like, you know, regardless of I guess, you know, how they handle themselves or what they've done, it's not, on one hand, it's not fair for me to judge them, especially if they are making an active effort to be, you know, better people in and out of competition, right?
True.
So I have spoken with people and changed my mind. But when I think about people that I don't want to cover, it's typically someone who is, look, if you're a troll, you're a troll. Like, that's one thing. But I mean, if you're just actively hateful and just sort of a vile person in general, I see no need to contribute and to give you a platform, a larger platform to do that on.
I can respect that.
So I look at it, right. I think a good example of that, of how media handles someone like that right now, mm-hmm. is President Trump's, I don't know, what is she, his advisor?
Oh, I don't know what her official title is. The spokesperson, I think I know what you're talking about.
Kellyanne Conway.
Yeah.
I mean, besides the fact that she has, she knew what she was doing and that she got him elected, but it's obvious that she has no idea it's obvious that many of them don't, but that she also has no idea sort of how to handle media and the fact that she continues to, either, whether I guess it's on purpose or not, tell lies or mistruths or argues with, and is combative with media, mm-hmm. that they are, they have now decided, CNN and other media outlets have decided they don't even want to have her on their shows or whatever anymore because it's not worth the airtime. I mean, all she's going to do is either be combative or lie about things.
It doesn't contribute to anything overall.
I mean, the Bowling Green thing is, I think that...
Oh, yeah. that was ridiculous.
I mean, she cited a Bowling Green massacre that never existed. And I think that's what drew the line with some media outlets. And that's kind of where I am. I'm like, look, I don't want to give someone a platform. I don't want my name associated with some people if they are the way they are. They can be that way if they want to be, if that's how they make a living. More power to you.
Now, to play devil's advocate, again, based on what we've talked about thus far and such, one might argue, again, people out there that might, like those different personalities, those different celebrities that are part of the scene and such, one might argue that that is technically still being grassroots to some extent. Now, again, obviously, that's a very subjective thing. And I'm of the mindset personally that if you're out in the spotlight like that and you got a lot of people watching you or getting behind you and stuff, you should lead by example, especially when you talk about positivity or you want things to grow and be more positive or be more awesome and become something even greater. I feel like you have to lead by example like that. And that's always a good thing that could be applied to just about anything in life and such. But some people might argue in this sense that that's still being grassroots, that that's still part of the culture and stuff. Would that still be something that would be like on your mind, like when you faced with that type of scenario?
I think there's a difference between being a part of this community and being someone who just sort of, does their best to sort of tear it down, in a sense.
Tear it down, break it all down, like Jericho.
Like they're free to do whatever they want to do. I'm not stopping them. I'm just not putting them, next to my name when I do my work. And at this point, like I said, it's really only down to a select, I guess, one or two individuals. But yeah, I mean, like guys are, look, let's, so like the F-Champ, Kane Blue River thing in Marvel last year.
I'm a little bit lost. I don't like quick summary of that if you can.
Basically, no one expected Marvel to be around, I think, after last year's Evo.
You mean Ultimate Marvel 3
specifically? Right. And F-Champ was, when did he win Marvel? I don't know. He won Marvel a few years ago. Mm-hmm. Kane Blue River won in 2015. And almost immediately after he won, F-Champ went after him on social media, whatnot. I just bullied the shit out of this guy.
Being vitriolic, basically.
He was a bully. I mean, the classic definition. The only thing he never did was, I guess start a fight with the guy. Although there's times where he was in his face and even, sort of put hands on him in a situation that I'm like,
that sounds a little tense.
If Kane Blue River wasn't the guy that he was, maybe he would have knocked him out. I don't know. But anyway, so they go almost a year with FChamp bullying this guy until it gets to a point, like, it's cringeworthy. I mean, I'm just like, you know, someone at some point should probably rein this in.
Yeah.
But they didn't. Nobody did. And luckily, you know, I feel like this is the only reason this is, a good story is the positive spin out of this is it boils up to the point where they have an exhibition. This was last January, I think. Mm. I think it was a first to 15.
It's a lot of games.
And they play a first to 15, and FChamp wins. And the whole time he is just in KBR's face. I mean, he is just,
he's talking smack.
It's obnoxious. And then the next day they play in tournament, and I think it was maybe like top 16 or maybe it was even top 8, and KBR lost. So he got sent to loser's bracket. Well, KBR made it all the way into grand finals, which, again, to meet up with FChamp. And he had to play two sets, of course, to win, because most fighting game tournaments are double elimination. So if you drop into loser's bracket and you make it to grand finals, you have to win one set to reset the bracket, mm-hmm. and then win a second set to win the tournament. And he actually won. And it was like...
Story.
It was like justice was served. And at the end, and look, I've spoken to both players since. I do believe that FChamp believes that he may have stepped over a line. But, you know, he wanted to provide some sort of WWE style villainous.
He wanted to be a heel.
He wanted to be a heel, but he wanted to preserve his community. So that was one way to do that.
That even fall into that? Because that's, to me, that's drama. But is that like good drama though? Like, that doesn't sound good.
That's the thing. It generated a lot of interest. And to me, the only reason it's good is because of the result, which is KBR won when it mattered the most.
It was an underdog story.
If he hadn't won this, you know, who knows? Maybe this all would have continued. I don't know. But, you know, after winning that tournament, FChamp out on the mic was like, I think he did end up apologizing to him, but also said that, you know, KBR through it all was like the better man, and et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. My point there is I think that players can do these things, can behave, even if they don't like someone, even if they're in a feud. Right now, probably the one to look out for is K-Brad and Wolfcrone.
I've heard about this before.
This is like the only current, maybe relevant feud people need to look out for in Street Fighter V. Recently, K-Brad beat Wolfcrone in a tournament, and then Wolfcrone met him again in the tournament and won the tournament by beating K-Brad. And they don't like each other. They're on record, like they streams, videos, whatever. They don't like each other. And Wolfcrone did this thing where he was wiping his hands together and kind of like, you know, shooing K-Brad off the game, whatever. Mm-hmm. That's just sort of a natural feud.
It's natural competition, natural
beef. but if players have beef with each other, whatever, that's fine. I just think that when you are someone who is actively hateful, I think ultimately it comes down to if you're a hateful person, and that's how you behave, and you treat people like shit, and you talk to people like shit, and that's, I mean, if that's how your popularity, if that's how you became famous, whatever, good for you. But I just don't want any part of that, and so I refuse to acknowledge that in my work.
I could understand that, and I think it's a good stance to take as someone that's covering stuff that's around there. Granted, you also identify as, like, you know, being able to interact with a lot of those people like that. I think that, you know, when you can limit negativity and you see it out there, is like, you obviously have a choice, like, just not to be dealing with it or not to be associated with it.
And from my perspective, like, I could cover, I guess this is the FGC versus Kotaku thing, right? Like, I could, yes, if it's newsworthy, I have to cover it. I'm obligated,
it's news,
right? But I mean, I could cover one negative person, or I could cover like a dozen, you know, maybe lesser known but positive stories. And sure, I would much rather tell a good story than just, you know, cover someone just for the sake of covering them.
Do you think that a lot of it also falls on the people, again, the observers, the other people that are part of that community that are watching all this unfold, help make a lot of those things what they end up becoming, like a lot of those feuds, a lot of those beefs, or a lot of those players that end up being hateful in some form or fashion that rise to that type of stardom? Do you think it's also on them as well to kind of like, you know where the line should be drawn?
I mean, you know, it's up to the individual how they want, I guess, to support something, or how they want, I guess, their scene to be seen. but at the end of the day, you know, it is fighting games, and you're free to be however you want. And if you have a following that enjoys what you do, you know, they'll support that. So, you know, more power to you. But I think there are, it's not like there's a lot of cases like this. So I feel like we can do better just sort of like self-policing other things rather than like, hey, this guy's an asshole and we shouldn't support him. Because you can't tell someone else what to do, right? Like they're exactly. going to support him, they're going to support him, whatever. but I think as a whole, we can sort of self-police other things that, make the community more approachable to people who maybe aren't necessarily part of it, or are sort of like, you know, hey, this fighting game looks cool. Like, how do I get involved? And it's more important for us to take care of those people and to help the community grow as a whole, I think.
I agree. I definitely agree to that. So let's kind of, you know, wrap up this definitive discussion. Can you give me two players? Okay, doesn't matter what games that they're from. And I would assume you probably choose Street Fighter V more than likely. But two players that everybody should be keeping their eyes on or should get excited about.
That are not known players?
It could be anything, known or not known. Because I know, you, like I mentioned earlier, you did a whole piece on Ricky Ortiz. You pretty much told her story there. So you gave a lot of shine to someone like that. I think you've talked to, again, Daigo. You did a documentary again. But give me two players. It could be anything out there that people should pay attention to.
I would say that for Street Fighter V, you know, you can always keep an eye on the big names. The good players are always going to be good, whether it's Infiltration, who won EVO last year. You know, Daigo, of course, and Justin Wong are like the two biggest names out there. To be fair, the people that I want to mention are probably they're smaller names in the fighting game scene and in Street Fighter, just because they've had more recent success, so people aren't going to necessarily know who they are. But if you're paying attention to Street Fighter, competitive Street Fighter, and you do happen to sort of, see what these guys are doing. I actually wrote an article recently, like seven players to watch in Street Fighter V. So keeping it with North America, because it's just easier to kind of pay attention. Idom from New York. I don't know what he did just this past week at Wednesday, or at Next Level Battle Circuit, which is a weekly in New York on Wednesdays. But it's a really high level weekly tournament, and Idom is a Laura player, and Laura is very high up in most people's tier list, and he is a I actually don't know how much he's been playing like prior to Street Fighter V, so he's a newer player in that, you know, in having success. Competes against guys like Alucard and Smug, who are established Street Fighter players. So Idom is a good one. IDOM. I think this year, I actually feel like there might be some people to look out from from the Seattle Pacific Northwest area. I'm curious to see what Nightmare 2450 does. He was in top four at Red Bull Proving Grounds last year, which Red Bull put on sort of an amateur style tournament to kind of showcase players from different regions
for Street Fighter V.
For Street Fighter V, which was pretty cool. So they held monthly tournaments in six different regions, and then brought the top three of those regions into a final, sort of like a final tournament. And Hugh was a top four player there. Nice. Again, my good buddy Kyle P is a Marvel player, but he also plays Laura in Street Fighter V. And again, Laura is, you know, sort of.
She got buffed, right? I think at one point for season 2.
Well, she actually didn't. I mean, sort of. A couple things got buffed, but overall, she's probably pretty much the same. Mm-hmm. I think people just ignored her because Mika was so strong.
Yeah.
And I guess the last one I'll say is Vagabond, who is from Houston. And he was at Red Bull Battlegrounds, which was in Seattle last year. It was the last premier event, which is an event that if you win, you automatically qualify for Capcom Cup, which is the finale of Capcom Pro Tour.
Nice.
And he had a really strong run. He made top 16, I think. And he beat Daigo 3-2.
Hey, that's not easy.
and that was with Daigo's playing Ryu, so that was before season 2, so it was this really strong Ryu. But other than that, other than that, you know, of course, there's plenty of top names you can look out for. Like I said, Justin Wong. I actually think that we're going to see players come up that didn't have as much success last year as they might have this year. Because of season 2. So PR Balrog's a good one. I'm glad that he's sort of playing again and he looks happy, because I think when he's having fun is when he's the most dangerous.
Nice.
And he's happy with Balrog to a degree. He's never going to be totally happy with him, but he's happier with Balrog. Echo Fox has, you know, come in and spent a ton of money signing the best players in the world. So they have Justin Wong, they have Momochi, they have Tokido. Anything Echo Fox is involved with, you'll definitely, if you want to follow a team in fighting games, Echo Fox is a team to look out for.
It's a lot of names, a lot of stuff. I'm pretty sure like anybody who listens to this now is going to have a lot of stuff, a lot of little research to do.
Yeah, and you know what? I mean, Knuckledew was the first American player to win Capcom Cup, and he was he's the first player to win a major. Not just, you know, like a major tournament, like one of the biggest tournaments, Street Fighter tournaments in the world. 20-year-old kid. So that guy's got a long career ahead of him.
That's awesome. That's really awesome. He's got a lot of good times ahead of him, which is cool. Which is dope. So either way, though, Mike, thank you for coming on here, chatting Street Fighter, fighting games, FGC with me. This was a fun discussion. Again, I learned a lot just overall.
Cool. Yeah, thanks. Anytime. I'm happy to talk whenever.
Definitely. So tell everybody, where can they find you? You're on Twitter. Where else can they find you?
On Twitter at @Bizarro_Mike. That's 1Z, 2 R's. Of course, I do all of the fighting game written and video content at Yahoo Esports. So esports.yahoo.com is the URL. If you go to YouTube, you can just look up Yahoo Esports and all of our videos go on there as well.
You're on a couple of them. I've seen you're on there on the mic.
Yeah. I mean, everything we do at this point goes on there. So all of the, I got next, I don't even think I mentioned this, but Conversations and Fireballs is kind of a cool new thing we started, where it's just, it's like what we're doing now, but it is a video. We record it and we just have a casual conversation about whatever.
Nice.
With any players, personalities that I get on. I don't know. Like I've been wanting to stream more. I keep saying this forever. I've been saying it forever.
On Twitch?
Yeah, Twitch. Twitch.tv/Bizarro13. Bizarro13. I need to stream more. So, you know, if you go over there and follow me, I promise I'll try to. As soon as I get my overlay the way I'd like it, then I'll stream more. I promise.
Nice. You'll probably be playing Street Fighter V over there. I know you were telling me at one point you wanted to play some more KI at some point.
Yeah, I actually need to. I haven't touched it since the last time I played it, but I want to play a little more KI. I think I haven't been motivated to play Street Fighter V as much lately just because...
that netcode, dude. I post some videos on Twitter.
No, I mean, for me, I think it's just because my interest level is low right now. And I think once Capcom Pro Tour starts, I will... not to mention I play Ryu, so I think I need to switch characters. But I think once Capcom Pro Tour starts, then I will feel more motivated. So yeah, twitch.tv/bizarro13. But yeah, I mean, if you ever want to reach out to me, you're more than welcome to. Oh, I have a Facebook page too.
Yeah.
Facebook.com/ So I started a page because people keep trying to like contact me or add me as friends. And I'm sorry, I don't
you're getting popular. They try to hit you.
I have a stranger danger. Like, I don't do strangers on Facebook. I still try to keep that a little bit limited. So yeah, facebook.com/FGC Mike, M-I-K-E. But yeah, streaming is something that I actually want to actively do more and also get more videos up on YouTube at some point. So, but if you ever want to contact me, dude, feel free to hit me up on Twitter. I'm probably checking Twitter way more than I need to.
And you can never check Twitter too much. You could always be checking Twitter. When you're not doing anything, you should be checking Twitter.
getting close to 4,000 nice. Followers.
Nice. Getting so, up there, man. That's good. Yeah. Again, guys, there'll be links to all that stuff in the description box below of this episode. So you could go to any one of those things right now while you're listening to it. So, again, thank you, Mike, for talking fighting games with me. Again, always a pleasure. You're always welcome on here. Don't forget, guys, subscribe to the channel, leave a like on this video, leave me a comment down below in the comment section. Let me know if you guys enjoyed this episode, if you enjoyed all the topics that we touched on. Let me know also who you guys want me to get on the show as a guest, what type of topics you want to see me talk about with them, and hopefully I can bring you guys some more cool definitive discussions on a bunch of cool different topics. So either way, guys, that's all I got for you. I will talk to you guys again very soon. Peace out, and stay epic, everybody.
Bye.